It's gonna be a bumpy ride. Hey, good morning, everybody. I'm so glad you're here with us this morning. Thanks for coming out on this beautiful, beautiful Sunday morning. And I just want to be one of the first to greet you. So I say to you today, Happy Sunday. Well, you picked a great time to come to church. How many of you are excited to be here today? Let's see the show of hands right there. All the hands are up like that. That makes me excited. You know what? It means the world to me that you're here today. Thanks so much for coming out to make this special effort to celebrate with us this morning. It's a great Sunday to be here because we're beginning a brand new series this very morning called Turn Your Setbacks into Comebacks. How many of you would agree with me when I tell you that life doesn't always go as planned? Yeah, right? How many of you would say, yeah, life is a bumpy ride? Yep, you'd agree to that also. You know, let's face it, we live in a broken world. And that means that every one of us experiences problems. And every one of us experiences losses in life. And every one of us experiences setbacks. And maybe you've been through some financial setbacks, or some family setbacks, or some health setbacks. Today we're going to focus on what to do when you're experiencing that. If you've ever felt discouraged, if you ever felt like you've put your heart and your soul into something and it just did not pan out for you, if you ever felt like you've worked hard but you've come up empty, this Sunday is for you. This is a good week for you to be here because you're going to need this message. Let me show you what a group of guys learned one day when they came face to face with Jesus. Now, this story is directly out of the Bible. It's found in Luke chapter 5, and it's a story of four guys. Peter and Andrew were brothers, and James and John were brothers, and all four of them were business partners. They were small business owners, and what they would do is they had a fleet of ships, a small number of ships that would go out, and they would haul the fish out of the sea. They'd weigh them and sell it wholesale in the marketplace. But on this particular work day, they've been out dragging the nets all night long. All night long. They've had it for at least 10 hours now, and they haven't caught a thing. I mean, nothing. And so you can imagine they're tired. They're frustrated. They're probably worried about how they're going to make payroll that week. And after working this entire night shift, they're just kind of washing down the nets, eager to get home. Well, at that moment, Jesus comes walking up to them. He comes walking along the beach, and I'll pick up the story right there. Here's what the Bible says. One day as Jesus was preaching on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, great crowds pressed in on him to listen to the word of God. He noticed two empty boats at the water's edge, for the fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. Jesus got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, that's Simon Peter, and he asked him to push out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. So can you picture it? So here's the scene. All these people are following Jesus around. By this point, Jesus is intensely popular. Just like everybody from the whole region are going out to see Jesus. And they want to be close to him. And they want to touch him. And they want to hear every word he has to say. They don't want to miss a thing that's going on. They're all trying to figure him out. And so he's now got a crowd that's numbering in the thousands that are with him, all pressing to get close to him at the same time. So what he does is he says, you know what? These people are going to wind up crushing me with the size of this crowd. He finds this empty boat, and he gets in the boat and pulls off just a little ways offshore. And there he starts teaching the people from the boat. So you just stop a minute and think about this and analyze it. Why is he doing this? Well, he's got some darn good practical reasons. First of all, he needed some breathing room, right? A crowd like that can get out of control. A crowd like that could crush him. It's growing and growing in numbers and intensity. More than that, water amplifies his voice, right? You realize that when you're talking to somebody on land, the land is absorbing the sound waves. But if you've ever been on a lake before, you ever had the experience where you can hear somebody on the other side of the lake laughing or talking? Because it carries across the water that way. So by being on the lake, the edge of the lake like that, Jesus can naturally talk to hundreds, maybe thousands of people at one time. But there's also a more important reason why Jesus is doing this. Jesus is about ready to ask these four men if they will become his first disciples. And he's going to ask them to leave their businesses behind. And by doing a miracle for them on this day, he's going to show them that he has the ability to take care of them, to provide for them, to make sure he can meet all their needs. And so he's going to do the type of miracle that they can understand as business people. He's going to do a miracle in their business. Here's what the Bible says. When Jesus finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Now go out into the deep water and let down your nets, and you will catch many fish." Remember, they've been working 10 hours, haven't caught anything. "Master," Simon replied, "we worked hard all night, and we caught nothing." You can hear the discouragement in his voice. And maybe you felt like that before. I mean, like you've worked hard, and you got nothing to show for it. You haven't made a sale. You haven't closed a deal. You haven't sold a house. In fact, maybe you would say, "And I'm out of work right now. I don't even have a job." I mean, sometimes you go through that in life. Sometimes you give it your best shot and you still fall 10 feet short. Sometimes you work hard and you work long and you work diligently and you've got nothing to show for it. Sometimes you hang in there with your marriage. And I mean, you go to counseling and you try different things and it just doesn't get any better. Or sometimes it's your job. And maybe you've experienced this. Some of you have experienced this where you've had this job for years now and you're good at your job and you're indispensable there and you never call out sick. They can depend upon you. And then all of a sudden, the industry changes or regulations change or there's a downturn or whatever. And you find that you're the one laid off from that job. What just happened? Well, I'll tell you what happened. You worked hard and you came up empty. You're just like those disciples in the Bible. You worked hard all night long and you got nothing to show for it. You've come up empty once again. And this miracle teaches us what to do when we come up empty. You need to understand how to get through that downturn in life, how to get through that setback in life, how to get through that dry spell in life. When these guys do what Jesus tells them to do, they not only experience a comeback, but they are blessed beyond all expectations. Their boat is overflowing, and their lives are changed forever. The Bible tells us the rest of the story. Listen how it ends. When Jesus finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Now go out into the deep water and let down your nets." When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. That's a lot of fish. They're being blessed beyond anything they can even handle. They're more than they can take in. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats as full of fish as they, so that they began to sink. Here's the point. They caught more in 10 minutes than they caught in the previous 10 hours. This is what we would call the miracle of acceleration. When God speeds up the process for you, when God speeds up the natural process or progression of events so that you get supernatural results. And when you understand the miracle of acceleration, you don't worry so much about timing. You don't worry if you have some months where you have a dry spell where nothing's biting. It doesn't really matter because you know that at any time God can turn on that faucet. Just like that, he can turn on the faucet. At any time, God can raise up his hand of blessing over you and change the situation entirely. At any time, your life could be entirely different because that's the kind of God that we have. The fact is, God can do more in 10 minutes. God can do more in your life in 10 minutes than you can do in 10 years. What makes a difference? What makes a difference between working all night long and coming up empty and having so much in your life that you can't take it all in? Jesus said, according to your faith, it will be done unto you. These guys did four things, four steps of faith. And I'll tell you what I'm going to do for you today. Let me do this. Let me teach you the first of the four steps. Because I want to dig deep into this, and I don't want to just highlight it in a surface way. So let me teach you the first one, but you know what? That means you have to come back next week for the rest of this sermon. It's going to be a two-week-long sermon. That's, you're going to say, how long was Pastor preaching today? Oh, man, he was going for 2 weeks this time. I know it feels like it a lot of times, right? This actually will be a two-week-long sermon. So we'll give you the next three out of the four steps that you need to take, that you want to take. We'll do that next week. But here's the first one, and this is so important. The first thing you need to do that Peter and Andrew and James and John did is I need to give Jesus complete access to my life. Let me tell you something right now as clearly as I can. If you are feeling discouraged, if you feel like you're spinning your wheels, if you feel like you're all right, but you could be doing better, I'm telling you, you and I, we need to give Jesus complete access to our lives. If I want to move from emptiness to overflowing, if I want to turn my setback into a comeback, if I want to experience the miracle of acceleration in my life, I need to give Jesus complete access to every area of my life. Notice what it says in verse 3. Jesus got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and he asked him to push out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. Here's the starting point, pretty simple. You got to get Jesus in your boat. Very simple, right? If I want to move from emptiness to fullness, I must get Jesus in my boat. Notice they worked all night long and caught nothing for 10 hours. Now in 10 minutes, they're bringing in more than they can handle. What's the difference here? Analyze it with me. It's the same lake. It's the same nets. It's the same fishing crew. It's the same business owners. It's even the same fish. The only thing that is different, the only difference between nothing and fullness, is Jesus in the boat. Do you think this makes a difference? You think it'll make a difference in your life? Oh yeah, you bet it will. This is a game changer. You get Jesus in your life, I'll tell you what, you've got Almighty God working with you. You're not fishing for yourself. You're not managing your career on your own anymore. You got Jesus on the job. You've got the master in control of your business. Now let's apply this to you specifically. Let's apply this to your life specifically. First question, what's your boat? What is your boat? Your boat is how you make a living. That's what it is. It's however you make a living. Peter's business is fishing. That boat is his livelihood. That boat represents his entire income. He gives his boat to Jesus. He gives his job to Jesus. What's your boat? It's your means of support. It's your livelihood. It's your salary, your benefits, your bonus, whatever. Second question, what does it mean to have Jesus in your boat? It means you dedicate your career to God. You dedicate your career to Jesus. Now, we're not talking salvation here. Some of you may have Jesus in your heart. You may have Jesus in your life right now. You may be assured that you've got a home waiting for you in heaven. And you thank God you come here on a Sunday morning and you praise God and you honor God and you thank God for all of his blessings. But then what happens a lot of times is this. You come here on a Sunday morning, but when you go to work on Monday morning, you kind of keep Jesus on a shelf. And Jesus is in no way involved in your everyday work life. He's certainly not using your job as a platform to get his message out. To give your boat to Jesus means you say, Jesus, I'm going to let you use my job as your platform. I dedicate my career to you for your use. Now, when Peter did this, he just had phenomenal results. But don't miss the sequence. First, Peter gives his job to Jesus. He lets Jesus use his job as a platform. Then Jesus blesses him with incredible success. Notice the sequence. See, what happens is a lot of time we get this backwards, don't we? I can't tell you how many times people have said to me, if God just will bless me with enormous success, I will use that success to serve God. If God just gives me a whole lot of money, if he gives me a great big salary, if he gives me a big platform in life, I will use that then to do good things. But what this is saying is, no, you got that upside down. Go to God right now, just as you are, and say, God, I'll be honest with you, sometimes I feel like a failure. God, I feel like I'm spinning my wheels. God, I feel like I could be a lot more effective. God, I don't know if I'm always doing this right. I'm not sure if my decisions are always correct. But God, you can have my business, my career, my job, such as it is. I give it to you. It can be your platform. You can use it. You can do whatever you want with it. And God, I will trust that you will bless that in the way that you see fit. I trust you're going to bless me with as much as you know I can handle. You see, that's what we're talking about today. It's like this. Remember this verse from the Bible. Matthew 6:33. Seek ye first, not second, third, fourth, or fifth. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. Not success, not a salary, not personal satisfaction. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and then all these other things will be added unto you. Put God first, and then all this other stuff you've been longing for, God will take care of. He'll give to you as well. Here's what I've learned in my own life. Whatever I want God to bless, I've got to put him first in. Whatever part of my life that I want God to bless, I've got to put him first. So if I want God to bless my day, I've got to give him the first part of that day. I got to take a few minutes at the beginning and reach out to him in prayer. Maybe read a little bit of the Bible. If I want God to bless my week, I give God the first day of the week, like you're doing right now. If I want God to bless my money, I give God the first part of my money. And let me tell you, for me, that last part was really a struggle. Because you have to understand, I spent a lot of years just like being a student and stuff like that. In fact, you know, I knew from the time I was like a teenager that the Bible tells us that we should tithe. That means give back 10% of whatever God sends your way. I knew that. But man, I was like, gee, God, you don't really expect me to do this, because after all, I mean, first of all, when I first started getting a job, I was a student. Let me tell you, when I was all the way into grad school, when I got married, you know what my salary was? I was making $200 a week. $200 a week, but I tithed. Then when I went to 4 years of college, 4 years of grad school, 4 years to get a doctorate, and then I finally got to this church. Oh, then I hit the jackpot when I got to this church. You know what my original salary was when I first got here? Now understand that I was a married man with two babies. I was making $300 a week then. $300 a week, but I tithed. Why? You say, Jeff, why in the world would you do that when you had barely enough to feed your family? Why would you tithe? I can tell you exactly why. Because that I couldn't afford not to have the blessing of God upon my life. I couldn't afford to not have God's blessing on my life. I needed God's blessing. If I was to take care of this family, if I was to take care of this church, if I was to live my life, I knew God would have to come up with a way to grow this church and grow the income and grow my salary and all that, because that's what he promised. So I had to trust him. And boy, let me tell you something, it worked. Let me tell you from my experience, from my life, it worked. So what you say is this, what I'm saying to you is this. I want you to say, Lord, you can use my business as your platform to spread the good news. Somebody says to you, hey, what do you do for a living? You say, well, I'm a missionary disguised as a real estate agent. No, don't say that. It just sounds weird. You're never going to sell a house sounding like that, okay? So think it. You go ahead and think it, but don't be weird, okay? In your mind, you think, you know what? I'm a missionary disguised as a truck driver, a plumber, an accountant, an electrician. I'm a missionary disguised as a cashier, disguised as a factory worker. You get the point. I am first and foremost using my career as a platform for Jesus. And then I just watch him bless my career. So the big question I'm throwing at you today is this. Have you committed your boat to Jesus? Some of you are going through a tough time right now, and you're trying to change everything else. Remember Peter's business? They didn't need to change their nets. They didn't need to change their boats. They didn't need to change their marriage. They just needed to get Jesus in that boat with them. That's what they needed. And some of you have been trying to change everything else. Some of you are thinking, well, maybe if I just even give up and move out of New England, go south where there's more jobs. Well, let me tell you, maybe, but not necessarily. Maybe you need to get Jesus in your boat. That's the first step. If you want to turn a setback into a comeback, look, you're going to need this sermon series that we're starting today. And I got to tell you, this miracle is recorded in Scripture for a reason. Next week, I'll teach you the next three steps of faith that you're going to want to take if you're sick and tired of coming up empty in life. But start here. Start today. Get Jesus in your boat. Let's bow our heads now and pray together. And would you pray from your heart? Lord, I fished all night and I've come up with nothing. I've come up empty once again. I'm discouraged. Feels like nothing's biting. So Lord, please get into my boat. Lord, I want to follow you. I'm committing my job, my career, my livelihood to you. From now on, it's your job. It's your platform. I give you complete access to my life, my job, my marriage, my friendships, my bank account. It's yours, Lord. I give it all to you. You get first consideration in all my decisions. The boat belongs to you. In your name I pray. Amen. And now we continue by praying together in unison. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.